Last week we saw that when God works on his people, he doesn't do it through external means. He doesn't do it by, as I was taught as a kid, you'd know the work of the Spirit of God because you would get Holy Ghost goosebumps, or someone would roll on the floor, or someone would speak in some other language that they had never learned. We saw that God instead works on his people internally. He works by his spirit from within a person. And as Paul wrote in Philippians 2, verse number 13, that it's not this outward stimuli or pressure that causes us to serve the Lord. It's not by something that the preacher stirs up through music or through an inspirational or motivational sermon. It's not by any kind of outward pressure tactic that God moves and causes us to either be saved or so that we serve him. But the scripture says God causes us both to will and to do for his good pleasure. And he does it internally rather than by external means. Men work from the outside, but God is the one who stirs the heart of mankind, and he does it sovereignly through the preaching of the word. And God, we saw, moved on the hearts of his people through the preaching of Haggai. And it was evidenced not by those Holy Ghost goosebumps, but by their obedience to him. And on September 21st of the year 520 BC, 21 days after Haggai's very first sermon, the people began again working on the temple, which they had started 16 years before, but through discouragement and disappointment had stopped. And everyone was involved, from the ordinary citizen to the religious leader and the civil leader. Everyone put their hand into the work of the Lord. But doing the will of God doesn't keep you from being discouraged or from disappointment. We get this image in our head that if we were serving the Lord with all of our heart, then life would be unicorns and rainbows and glitter, and everything would just be great and grand. The reality from Scripture reveals the fact that serving the Lord can involve discouragement as well as disappointment. This morning, we're being reminded that the future belongs to God. Haggai chapter 2, we'll start with verse 1 and read through verse number 9. In the seventh month, on the 21st day of the month, the word of the Lord came by Haggai the prophet, saying, "Speak now to Zerubbabel, the son of Shealtiel, governor of Judah, and to Joshua, the son of Jehozadak, the high priest, and to the remnant of the people, saying, 'Who is left among you who saw this temple in its former glory? And how do you see it now in comparison with it? Is this not in your eyes as nothing? Yet now be strong, Zerubbabel,' says the Lord, 'and be strong, Joshua, the son of Jehozadak, the high priest, and be strong, all you people of the land,' says the Lord, 'and work, for I am with you,' says the Lord of hosts, 'according to the word that I covenanted with you when you came out of Egypt, so my spirit remains among you. Do not fear. For thus says the Lord of hosts, once more, it is a little while, I will shake heaven and earth, the sea and dry land, and I will shake all nations, and they shall come to the desire of all nations. And I will fill this temple with glory, says the Lord of hosts. The silver is mine, and the gold is mine, says the Lord of hosts. The glory of this latter temple shall be greater than the former, says the Lord of hosts. And in this place I will give peace, says the Lord of hosts." Our passage today starts with a present disappointment. The date of this is set to approximately October 17th of 520 BC, and it was the final day in what the scripture calls the Feast of Tabernacles. And you can read more detail about this feast in Leviticus chapter 23. The Feast of Tabernacles was held in the fall, and it was a yearly reminder of God's provision during Israel's 40 years wandering in the wilderness. Remember, as the children of Israel wandered for those years in the Sinai Peninsula, they were fully dependent on God. They were people that were on their way to a promised land, but God had given his promise, and they were making their way very slowly through that land. But as they went, God provided for them. The scripture says that he provided water for them in places where there was no natural water. He provided food for them as manna from heaven. When they left Egypt, he provided for them clothes and shoes. God's provision for them was complete physically. The feast was a reminder to them that God was their provider. This Feast of Tabernacles was also a reminder for that particular year. As the people brought in the harvest, they were to remember that God provided every day for their needs. It was very much like our American Thanksgiving holiday, a reminder to give the Lord thankfulness that is due him. So the Jewish people celebrated this Feast of Tabernacles by abandoning their homes for an entire week, for 7 days. And rather than live in their homes, they would live in temporary shelters, or in some Bible translations, you'll find the word booth. And they would take tree branches and construct them into something like a small tent, and they would live for 7 days in those tents. These shelters reminded the people that they were not to settle in this world, but they were to be like Abraham and continue looking for God's provision. Remember that Abraham was given the land of Canaan by God, and yet Abraham never constructed a house in that land. He lived his entire life in that land in a temporary structure. And Hebrews chapter 11 tells us why he didn't build a house. It's because he was actually looking for a land and for a city that God had made, that God had prepared for him. And you and I would today know that as heaven. Abraham understood that this world was not his home. Do you remember the old gospel song that we used to sing many years ago? This world is not my home. I'm just a passing through. If heaven is not my home, then Lord, what will I do? The angels beckon me from heaven's open door, and I can't feel at home in this world anymore. This movement called the prosperity gospel is looking for things right here, right now, your best life now, instead of looking for our treasure in heaven with God. When the Jews returned to their homeland in 536, there was great excitement as they laid the foundation of the temple. Turn in your Bible backward to the book of Ezra, chapter number 3. Ezra is one of those books that teaches us the history of the Jewish people. And let's take up in verse number 8. Now in the second month of the second year of their coming to the house of God at Jerusalem, Zerubbabel, the son of Shealtiel, and Joshua, the son of Jozadak, do these names seem familiar to you? Mm-hmm. We're reading about them in Haggai. So Zerubbabel, Joshua, and the rest of the brethren, the priests and the Levites, and all those who had come out of the captivity to Jerusalem, began work and appointed the Levites from 20 years old and above to oversee the work of the house of the Lord. Then Joshua with his sons and his brothers, Kadmiel and his sons, and the sons of Judah rose as one to oversee those working on the house of God. The sons of Henadad with their sons and their brethren, the Levites, when the builders laid the foundation of the temple of the Lord, the priests stood in their apparel with trumpets, and the Levites, the sons of Asaph, the cymbals, and to praise the Lord according to the ordinance of David, the king of Israel. And they sang responsively, praising and giving thanks to the Lord. What does it mean to sing responsively? There are two different ways to sing responsively. One of the ways is the leader will sing one line, the congregation will repeat that line. In many places where they don't have that luxury of hymnals, they will still sing responsively. Now, sometimes responsive singing is done a little different, in which the leader will sing almost like a solo, And when it becomes time, the people will sing a chorus or a line. We do this every Sunday in our congregation. We have what is called a responsive Bible reading. One person leads out, they read one verse of scripture, and then we as a congregation say the next line of scripture. So we are speaking, we are responding to one another. The people here, as they begin to lay the temple's foundation, sing responsively. And their singing is not called worship, but their singing, noticed, is called praise and the giving of thanks. And we actually have a record of what it is that they sing. For he is good, for his mercy endures forever toward Israel. Then all the people shouted with a great shout, and they praised the Lord, because the foundation of the house was laid. But many of the priests and Levites and heads of the fathers' houses, who were old men, who had seen the first temple, wept with a loud voice when the foundation of this temple was laid before their eyes. Yet many shouted aloud for joy, so that the people could not discern the noise of the shout of joy from the noise of the house of the weeping of the people. For the people shouted with a loud shout, and the sound was heard afar off. You have these people who are filled with such joy and exuberance. The temple which had been destroyed was now being rebuilt. That symbol that God was present with them, they could see it begin to form before their eyes, and they rejoiced in that. But there were others, older men, who had seen the temple of Solomon. They knew what it looked like. They knew its grandeur and its glory, and they could see the thing coming before their very eyes was not anything like what they had remembered. The present was not as good as those, quote, good old days. And it caused them to lament, to weep, and cry out. And in fact, the crying was so loud that it equaled the cries of joy, so that you couldn't tell if the crowd was excited or if the crowd was dejected. The work that they had begun here in Ezra soon met with opposition, and the people gave up because it just seemed to be too hard with all the conflict. And 16 years passed before that work restarted, right here in the book of Haggai. They've been working now for 24 days. Discouragement sets in. And what is their discouragement? Haggai chapter 2, look at verse 3. Who is left among you, the Lord says, who saw this temple in its former glory? And how do you see it now? In comparison with it, is this not in your eyes as nothing? Here in Haggai's day, their disappointment was genuine, it was real. And it was due to the fact that some of the remnant, some of this group, working with Haggai, remembered seeing what God had done before in Solomon's temple 70 years earlier. And the thing they were doing right now was nothing compared to what they used to have. How often is that how we respond to the work of the Lord? We have in our minds this picture of what we think God is doing, or what God did at some point in our past or at some point in history. And we think this is nothing the same. And so we become discouraged. Now, what were they comparing their work to? They were looking back and remembering what they had seen of Solomon's temple. That temple built by Solomon, you can read about it in 1 Kings chapter 5 and in chapter 6, as well as 1 Chronicles 29. That temple rose 11 stories into the air. We seem to think that we invented high-rise buildings, but we didn't. Where did the first high-rise building come from? It came by a man by the name of Nimrod on the plain of Babylon, where the people built the Tower of Babel as a way to reach up and say, hey, God, we're equals with you. The first high-rise was man's opposition to God. Solomon's 11-story building provided more than 1 million square feet of building space. That's huge. And they had more than 8 million pounds of gold were used by the 153,000 laborers. Today, if we were to take 8 million pounds of gold, it would cost more than $217 billion. Let me give you something to compare that with. Today, it takes 3,500 Americans working for 1 year to earn just $100 million. And we're talking $217 billion. Solomon's temple was a really spectacular wonder in the ancient world. It was beautiful with the gold and the silver and the marble. When the sun would hit it, it could be seen for miles and miles away. But what was it that made the temple special? It wasn't the gold and it wasn't the silver. Was the presence of God in the midst of his people. Turn now to the book of Exodus, the very last chapter. Exodus chapter 40. We'll start with verse 34. Moses had constructed the tabernacle, the tent of meeting. They dedicated it to the Lord. They said, Lord, this is for you. And look at what happens in verse 34. Then the cloud covered the tabernacle of meeting. And the glory of the Lord filled the tabernacle. And Moses was not able to enter the tabernacle of meeting because the cloud rested above it, and the glory of the Lord filled the tabernacle. When the cloud was taken up from above the tabernacle, the children of Israel went onward in their journeys. But if the cloud was not taken up, then they did not journey until the day that it was taken up. For the cloud of the Lord was above the tabernacle at day, fire was over it by night, in the sight of all the house of Israel, throughout all their journeys. God's presence was given a physical manifestation in this cloud, that by day it looked like a cloud, and at night it looked like a pillar of fire. But it was a symbol that God was there in the midst of them, and the presence of God would be so heavy, so thick, in this cloud that even Moses, when he went in, couldn't stand before the Lord. Now, this corresponds, though, with something that we read a little later in the book of 1 Kings, chapter number 8. In the book of 1 Kings, we find Solomon taking all the materials and the plans that his father David had set aside. And when it's all done, they bring the Ark of the Covenant in and look down in 1 Kings chapter 8. And let's start in verse number 10. And it came to pass, when the priests came out of the holy place, after they've taken the Ark of the Covenant in, that the cloud filled the house of the Lord, so that the priests could not continue ministering because of the cloud. For the glory of the Lord filled the house of the Lord. Then Solomon spoke. The Lord said, He would dwell in the dark cloud. I have surely built you an exalted house and a place for you, O Lord, to dwell in forever. I want you to notice one interesting thing here. When we see pictures or we see movies of this cloud that was the presence of the Lord, it's always pictured as something bright and shiny. It's got lights and sparkles coming out of it. But how did King Solomon describe this cloud? He described it as a dark cloud. I get so disappointed at some of these preachers who claim that the Lord appeared to them in a cloud. The church down in Redding, California, where they claim to have apostles and prophets, and they have given testimony that they've seen, you know, this cloud, this shiny cloud appear, and dust made of gold has flown down, and they took a vacuum cleaner or a broom, they could sweep up all of that gold dust, and they could take that gold and sell it, and they would never have another need. They'd never need to take another offering. There's a man who claims to be a prophet in Kenya, and in one of his meetings, he claims that he called down the glory of God out of heaven to demonstrate who he was. And he claims that he is one of the two end time witnesses described in the book of Revelation. And one of his meetings, you can go on YouTube and watch the video, where he claims to have called down the glory from heaven. He staged it all so that he could claim something that he was not. And the people are ignorant of Scripture and believe anything and everything that they see and hear and experience. Experience is not always the truth. Truth comes from the Word of God, and if we know the Word of God, we know this man isn't one of the two witnesses. We know he's not a prophet. We know this man cannot call the glory of God out of heaven. And one of the reasons is that the Scripture tells us in the Gospel of John, the glory of God is manifested in Jesus. And when that prophet claims to call the glory of God out of heaven, what is he really saying? He's calling Jesus out of heaven. And Jesus doesn't beckon to the command of any man. He is God. In the day of Solomon dedicating the temple, the presence of the Lord appeared as a sign that he was with his people. In the book of Ezekiel, chapters 10 and 11, Ezekiel has a vision. And the vision includes some things that, by reading it, seem very odd. We won't go into detail trying to explain those things. But the point is this. Ezekiel sees a vision of all kinds of activity going on in the temple in Jerusalem. People are bringing their tithes. People are bringing offerings. People are praying. People are singing. Sacrifices are going on. Remember the tabernacle in the wilderness? When the glory cloud rose and moved, it was a signal that God was moving his people somewhere else. And in Ezekiel's day, he sees the glory cloud get up out of Jerusalem, leave the temple, and go to the land of Babylon. God is giving an image of the fact that he is going to be leading his people out of the land of Canaan, out of the land of promise, and he's taking them to a far land where they will be slaves. So all this time, when Ezekiel sees this vision of the presence of God getting up and leaving, there's a period of 125 years until the Babylonian captivity happens. So this is what I want you to understand, that the presence of God got up and left, went to Babylon, but the people continued their religious expression. They continued bringing their sacrifices. They continued going there to pray. They continued being there to sing their songs. But God had abandoned the place. And what Haggai's people remembered was just an outward form of religion. And this morning, I wonder, here in our city of Portland, how much outward show of religion is going on, but the one missing is God himself. These people in Haggai's day, they were remembering the grandeur of the temple, all the activity that was going on there, but God wasn't present. God doesn't appear today in a cloud. God's Old Testament glory was actually a representation of Jesus, and his flesh veiled that glory. But one day, that glory is again going to be revealed in his second coming. But where is the glory of the Lord today? Where is the sign of his presence? It's in you. It's in me. It's in his people. 2 Corinthians chapter 3, verse number 18. God's glory right now today resides within his church. And if you are one of his people, his glory, his presence resides within you in the person of Jesus Christ. There was a present disappointment, but also God leads them to a past covenant promise. Haggai chapter 2, verses 4 and 5. God tells the people, what you're doing now doesn't compare to the past. But now be strong, Zerubbabel, says the Lord. Be strong, Joshua, son of Jehozadak, the high priest. Be strong, all you people of the land, and work, because I am with you. Notice what God does in verse number 5. God doesn't give them a new word or a new revelation. He sends them back to an old word. Verse 5. So be strong, get back to work, I'm with you, according to the word that I covenanted with you when you came out of Egypt. So my spirit remains among you. Do not fear. So as the people are recalling that empty but busy shell of religion, and they became disappointed, God took them back to his covenant that he made with their ancestors more than 900 years earlier. He didn't give them something new, but he reminded them of something old. Church, today we don't need prophets, we don't need apostles, we don't need fresh messages from the Lord. What we need is to go back to the Bible. If it was good enough in Haggai's day, then it's good enough in our day. God told these disappointed Israelites to be strong. The word literally means to take courage and get back to work. We like to think of ourselves as strong people, but it's actually in our weaknesses that God's strength is revealed. Rich, famous, powerful, and big is meaningless in God's plan, but small, weak, and insignificant also means nothing in his plan. Life's meaning is not in our condition or our circumstance. Life's meaning is in God. 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verse number 7. A little over a month ago, we were at the city of Seaside on the Oregon coast, and we were spending a few days there. It's been our tradition as a family to do this late October, early November every year. And we were at the hotel where we stay. I'd gotten up early to make the coffee and for Kim and I to get ready for the day ahead. And I went in to take the shower. And I sat down on the edge of the bathtub, and I had one of my glitches. I suffer from brain injury from a car accident, and one of the things that happens on occasion is that my brain short circuits, and the result is that I get extremely confused and forget anything and everything. And there are some physical things that happen as well. Normally, my glitches last for just a second at the very most. It's like the snap of my finger, and I can tell that it happened. This particular glitch was different. The glitch was very minor, but it seemed to go on and on and on. The glitch stopped, and I stepped out of the bathroom, and I told Kim, I just had a glitch. And she knows the routine, and she says, you need to get into bed, you need to lay down, and you need to go to sleep, because that's the best thing for you. So I went in and into the bed, and I laid down. And to this day, I don't remember any of the beach trip. It completely erased my memory. But it created this weakness physically and mentally in me so that I didn't know who Kim was. I didn't know where I was. I didn't know who I was. In fact, one of the things was that I cried over and over because I didn't know where my mother was. I didn't know who this woman was in front of me. I was concerned about my mother. And we had taken Daniel and Matthew, and for the first time we'd taken Demita. It was really kind of humbling that here we have Demita, only known her a couple of months, and she's now seeing me at my weakest. And it was bad enough that I was laying there in the bed. Everybody had left the hotel room at one point as I was sleeping, because I'll sleep for literally a day or two at a time and not get up. And I was laying there sleeping. And at some point in the day, I had gotten up and gone into the bathroom. And when everybody got back to the hotel room, they could hear the water running in the shower. And after a while, somebody had to go to the bathroom. So Kim came to see what was going on in the bathroom with me. And I was laying there on the floor, and I was crying because I couldn't get my shirt off over my head. And how many hours I'd been laying on the floor crying, we don't know. It's in those moments of weakness. It's in those times when we have no spiritual strength. It's in those times when we are at our worst, the strength of God is manifested, because we stop relying on who we are and what we can do, and we have nowhere to turn but to the Almighty God. And God's strength and his presence for Haggai's day was founded not in something new and some experience, but it was founded in the covenant that he made way back at Mount Sinai. God was, and he had been, faithful to his promise, and he'd continue to be faithful to them. Why? Because that's who God is. God is faithful, And every promise that he makes, he is faithful to. That's his character. And if his promise to Israel was so wonderful, then how much more wonderful should you and I be thinking of his covenant made to us through his own blood? Like Israel looking back at Sinai, you and I look back, but what do we look back to? The death of Jesus. And there we find our hope and we find our inheritance, not in something new, but in something that is ancient. And this all leads us to look forward to a future glory. Haggai chapter 2, start with verse number 6. For thus says the Lord of hosts, once more, it is a little while, I will shake, future tense, I will shake heaven and earth and the sea and dry land, and I will shake all nations, and they shall come to the desire of all nations. And I will fill this temple with glory, says the Lord of hosts. Notice this is all God. He's the sovereign. He's the one guiding history. Verse number 8, the silver is mine and the gold is mine, says the Lord of hosts. The glory of this latter temple shall be greater than the former, says the Lord of hosts. And in this place I will give peace, says the Lord of hosts. So just like at Mount Sinai, God said he would once more shake heaven and earth, because that's what he did when the people camped at Mount Sinai. Remember the flashes of lightning, the dark cloud that covered the mountain? Well, just like at Sinai, God is once again going to do this. But it's not going to be something local on a little mountain in the Sinai Peninsula. It's going to encompass the entirety of the heavens and the earth. The universe is going to shake. And in Hebrews chapter 12, verses 25 through 29, the author quotes this passage from Haggai and gives us an explanation. When God descended on Mount Sinai, he shook the mountain. And the people, remember, were afraid. They were terrified. And even though they had this experience of terror, they didn't believe in him and they didn't obey him. In fact, they went and started worshiping a God made by their own hands. God, as a result of that, banned them from entering the promised land. It wasn't because of their sin, it was because of their unbelief. And having a religious experience doesn't always result, folks, in salvation. There are people of every religious stripe who have religious experiences, but that doesn't mean that they are saved. It doesn't mean they're following the same God that you and I follow. Shaking in the Bible, though, is always a picture of God in his judgment. And Hebrews chapter 12 says that one day God is going to shake all of creation. And here's the connection he makes with Haggai. If Israel was responsible to him when he shook Mount Sinai, how much more will all of humanity be when he shakes the universe? This universal shaking is going to happen at a future day, according to Haggai. When is that day going to come? Well, it's going to come when Jesus returns to the earth to set up his kingdom. In Matthew chapter 24, verses 29 and 30, chapter 25, verse 32, we have Jesus in his own words describing his return to the earth. And when he returns, there's going to be great cosmic events, and there's going to be a shaking of everything. Everything that man has done, every memorial to man, every institution is going to be shaken, brought down to its very foundations. Everything of man's design is going to give way to heaven's design and heaven's leading citizen. We need to remember that in this life, we need to hold on to the things that don't shake. Psalm 125 begins, those who trust in the Lord are like Mount Zion, which cannot be shaken but endures forever. Now, what doesn't shake in our world? The only thing that doesn't shake is God's word and God himself. You can't trust the government. You can't trust the bank account. It could be the person sitting next to you that you are married to. You can't always trust in that person. That person will possibly betray you. That person will fail you. couple of weeks ago, I got up in the morning as our usual routine. I get up and make either a pot of coffee or some tea. Then I go in and start the shower for Kim, get it warmed up. And I was sitting on the floor in the bathroom praying, waiting for her. She didn't show up. So after about 20 minutes, I got up and went into the bedroom and she was laying there in bed. She said, "There's something wrong. I can't get up." And she was experiencing extreme dizziness. That she said, even if she rolled over or shifted herself a little bit in the bed, she got nauseous like she was going to vomit. The room was spinning around her. We tried, you know, sitting up, we tried standing up, we tried doing some slow movements, and she just couldn't do it. And here she was supposed to be on her way to work. Well, you know, I don't drive anymore. She needed to go to the emergency room at the hospital. But she's the only one that can drive. So it was interesting, and got her up and got her ready and got into the car, and I drove to the hospital. And I didn't do too bad, did I? I did a pretty good job. Here's this woman that I rely on so much because of my own physical liabilities. And that morning, I couldn't rely on her. My world was shaking. Her world was shaking. But God's kingdom doesn't shake. It reminds us that God is the eternal one whom we need to trust in. We sang this morning that great hymn by Edward Mote. In the third verse, he says, "His oath, his covenant, his blood support me in the whelming flood. When all around my soul gives way, he then is all my hope and stay. On Christ the solid rock I stand, all other ground is sinking sand. All other ground is sinking sand." Today, are you standing on shaky sand, or are you on the solid rock of Jesus Christ? Your future, church, rests in Christ Jesus and his work at the cross of Calvary. When Jesus returns, the scripture says that the nations will come and God would fill this temple with glory. God initially filled the earthly temple in Jerusalem with his glory when Solomon dedicated it. But when Jesus comes back to this world, he's going to come into the Jerusalem temple at his second coming. Now, that temple doesn't exist today, but it will be rebuilt. The scriptures, the Old Testament, confirms to us again and again that there will be another temple, and Jesus will come to that temple, and it will be filled with the glory of God. The glory of God is Jesus Christ. And at that time, the nations of the world will bring all of their wealth and adorn that temple, because all the wealth belongs to God, and God is going to say, "Bring that gold, bring that silver, because it's mine, and I will adorn my temple." Just as this temple was very simple and nondescript in the days of Haggai, and God says, "Don't worry about it. There's going to come a temple that I'm going to decorate." And so he will do that one day, because all belongs to him. This temple, this what we would call millennial temple, is going to stand, as Haggai says, in this place. It is going to be in Jerusalem. And it will be most glorious, not because of the gold and silver, but because Jesus is there. And when Haggai uses this phrase, "in this place," it reveals that this temple is not a symbol. It is literal. It's a literal temple in a literal place in a literal future time. Now today, the church is described as the temple of the Lord, metaphorically, symbolically. The scripture also says that the Father and the Son are the temple. Now, just because we have symbols doesn't deny the physical reality of a future millennial temple. If Christ's second coming is literal, then the temple must be literal that he's going to come into. The remnant in Jerusalem in Haggai's day was discouraged when the temple they were building wasn't as grand as what they remembered from the past. And they became disappointed. Their work wasn't as wonderful or as glorious as God deserved or they remembered. And God told them not to be concerned because he's going to adorn his temple in his way, at his time. And the future is brighter than anything their past ever knew. And church, our future is brighter than anything our past ever points to. The practical application for you and me right now is that we need to turn our eyes away from our present difficulties and look toward what God is doing in the future. All too often we forget that God is actively working today. He's working in all the circumstances of your life, and he's working them, the scripture tells us, together for our good and for his glory. And Paul in 2 Corinthians chapter 4 reminds us that your present affliction, your light affliction, which is but for a moment, is working for us a far more exceeding and eternal weight of glory. The struggles and disappointments and trials of life today weigh heavy upon you, but the weight of today does not match the weight of God's glory in the future in heaven with him. God said that the future belonged to him, and he reminds you and he reminds me today of that very same truth. The future belongs to God. In every trial of life, fix your eyes on Jesus. He's the author. He's the finisher of our faith. And view the present through the promises of God. Last Friday night, we attended a monthly sing-along at a church. There were a couple hundred people got together, and we were singing Christmas hymns. And we get together every month, and that's all we do is sing hymns. And when it was over, a woman came and she sat down next to me and she said, "Do you remember me?" Now, because of my brain injury, I have a real hard time remembering names, but I don't forget a face. I may not know who you are, but I know if I've seen you before. And I said, "I'm sorry, I know that I know you, but I don't know who you are." And she laughed and she says, "That's okay, you told me that." About a year ago, we were downstairs here at the sing-along, and you came and sat down next to me. And when we started singing the hymn, "Leaning on the Everlasting Arms," you got to the chorus, "Leaning on Jesus, leaning on Jesus, safe and secure from all alarms." And every time we sang the words "leaning," you leaned over against me. She said, "It totally freaked me out." I've had a lifetime of experience with men, and it's always been very negative. It's been very hurtful. And here was this strange man leaning against me every time we sang "Leaning on Jesus." But you were kind enough, after the meeting was over, you spent, what was it, an hour or two talking to me. So one of the things that you told me about yourself is that you, as a pastor, get discouraged, that it doesn't seem that you're having an effect on anybody, that your preaching just goes off into the air and it doesn't change anybody or anything. She said, "I want you to know that the time that you took and you talked with me that night changed my life. I now understand that there are indeed men in the world who can be trusted, who are godly, who are not going to hurt me." She's looking forward to improving her health. She's looking forward to getting back into going to church. She said at the time that I had offered to friend her on Facebook, there was just no way I could do it. I couldn't do it because I couldn't trust any man for anything. But now, if you're willing and your wife is okay with it, I would like to be your friend on Facebook. That time that you spent with me was not in vain. It's easy when you're doing the Lord's work to find a present disappointment. But God told the children of Israel through Haggai to look back to his past covenant promises and look forward to a future glory. The future belongs to God.